Now let's get into the good stuff. Kamala Harris has essentially clinched the nomination to be our next nominee for the Democratic Party and to run for president. All state Democratic Party chairs have endorsed Harris. A majority of delegates support her, including all the delegates, all 91 of us in Arizona. 186 Democratic House members, 43 senators, and 23 governors endorsed Harris. And in 3 days, she raised $250 million in online donations and major donor commitments. And that's since Sunday. So that gives you an idea of just how strong the groundswell of support is. And our own U.S. Senator Mark Kelly, making things interesting, he might be a possible VP candidate. Before we went any further, all of us owe a huge amount of gratitude and admiration to Joe Biden. He sacrificed his 52-year career for the greater good of the Democratic Party. I mean, how many of us can make this say the same thing? Joe has brought us an economy that created a record 60 million jobs. He brought inflation down to 3.5%. He made healthcare cheaper. He signed the first major gun safety legislation in 30 years. And he brought down illegal border crossings by 40% with an executive order that he signed. And Kamala Harris will build on this record of accomplishment. She is going to restore women's abortion rights nationwide. She's going to save Social Security and Medicare. She's going to protect us from climate change. And she's going to save us from a dictatorship. The other day, I was working in my office, and I got one of two calls from Yolanda Bejarano, the Arizona Democratic Party chair. She basically mentioned to me that what Democrats need to do now is to turn worry into work and fear into fight. And we have some terrific, outstanding Democratic candidates right now that deserve our support, including for U.S. Senate, Ruben Gallego, for U.S. Congress, Kristen Engel in CD6, and Raul Grijalva in CD7. We have three excellent candidates for the Arizona Corporation Commission. This is the commission that regulates electricity rates and decides whether or not we have solar power broadly in Arizona. Candidates are Joshua Palachek, John Hill, Elenia Aguilar, and I've seen them all speak. They're excellent candidates. And also we have our very own LD18 legislators, including Representative Nancy Gutierrez, whom we'll hear from later on, and Representative Chris Mathis, and Senator Priya Sundaresan. So get your cell phone ready in case you want to scan some of the QR codes that I'm going to be showing you in just a second. You can volunteer and get signs at the Harris for President office. It's the same location, 2752 North Campbell Avenue, and you can scan these QR codes if you would like to knock doors or scan the QR code for virtual phone banking. And we have our own LD18 contact, and that's Joey Scholhammer. And there is his email address and his telephone number. You can also find this information on the LD18 website. And look at all these happy Democrats. You know, we're all thrilled. We're all delighted. We're finally coalescing on a candidate who's going to win. Now, I want to let you know, the primary is a week from today. It's on July 30, and the deadline passed today for you to mail your ballot in. Now, what you can still do is deliver your ballot to the recorder's office or any one of 18 vote centers. The last day that you can vote early in person is July 26. But we also have emergency voting on 2 days, July 27 and 29. And if you have any questions about this, please scan the QR code. It will lead you to the recorder's site and all the information is there. And then, of course, you can vote in person at a vote center. And the recorder has set up 18 of them. Now, without further ado, let's hear from our Pima County attorney candidates. The way that we've set it up is each candidate will receive 10 minutes to make their points, to tell us about what they stand for, and that will be followed by 10 minutes of Q&A. When you want to ask a question, put it in the chat. Monica will spot it and she will read it. I did a coin toss and Mike Jette won the coin toss, so he's going to go first. Mike Jette has a 17-year tenure in various legal positions. He began his career as a deputy county attorney in the Santa Cruz County, and he was an assistant attorney general in the Arizona Attorney General's office, and eventually became an assistant U.S. attorney. And we also have Laura Conover, who is the incumbent Pima County attorney. She is a lifelong Democrat and has brought down the homicide rates and robbery rates by 36% and 39%, respectively, for the last 2 years. She cleared the homicide case backlog, reestablished the fraud unit, ended charging minors as adults, ending seeking the death penalty, and secured the first countywide pay raise since 1997. Laura, would you put Mike Jette in the spotlight so that we can hear what he has to say? Hello, Mike, you have the floor. Tell us.
Good evening, everyone. I appreciate the opportunity to be here with you. I think we've got over 100 or 110 people here tonight. So I appreciate everyone coming on a Tuesday evening. So as said before, I guess I won the coin toss. My name is Mike Jette, and before we get into any of the details, I am, contrary to what some people may have said, I am pro-choice. I got the National Organization of Women endorsement. I've always been pro-choice. I'm pro-environment. I was president of Tucson Clean and Beautiful for 7 years. I've always been pro-environment. And I've also been pro-universal healthcare. I'm a triplet, and both my triplet brothers were born with serious illnesses, and I've always been pro-universal healthcare. So I'm a Democrat through and through. For those who don't know, I grew up in a Marine Corps house. My mom was a librarian. My father was a 26-year Marine. I went to University of Oregon for undergrad school, and I went to Lewis and Clark in Portland to be an environmental lawyer. I had a brother who got sick here in Tucson, and I moved to Tucson 23 years ago, and I've been here in Tucson ever since. I earned a master's in business from Thunderbird in Phoenix, and I also earned a master's in international security from the University of Arizona. My wife is a professor of 23 years at U of A, and most people we would talk about my career as a prosecutor. So I started Santa Cruz County about 17 years ago, where I was a victim prosecutor, and I handled cases from homicides to burglaries to white collar. And during my tenure in Santa Cruz County, I was prosecuting two police officers who did some bad things on duty. And during that trial, the Attorney General's office was watching, and so they recruited me to the Arizona Attorney General's office here in Tucson, where then I became a white collar public corruption specialist. And I'd handled some of the biggest cases here in Tucson, from the Rio Nuevo investigation to the largest copper heist case in U.S. history. And so I made a name for myself as a white collar public corruption prosecutor. The U.S. Attorney's Office came calling, and who wouldn't jump at the U.S. Attorney's Office? That is the capstone of any prosecution career, is the U.S. Attorney's Office. So John Leonardo, the U.S. Attorney at the time, recruited me, and I walked into the white collar public corruption. And what a wonderful opportunity that was, because I was able to represent the United States and represent victims of some serious crimes, which impacted not only the state of Arizona, but the United States as a whole. And as a capstone of that career, the Department of Justice assigned me to go overseas to Pakistan and other East Asian countries, where I set up prosecution offices, trained and hired prosecutors, mentored prosecutors, set up offices from brick and mortar all the way to the HR, handled budgets from U.S., U.N., and Pakistani funds. And so what a great opportunity that was to represent you all, the United States, and to promote the rule of law overseas. I came back. I had a broken jaw from a court kerfuffle. That's a whole other story unto itself. And then I came here to the United States, came back to the office, and I was encouraged to run for the county attorney's office based upon what was happening at the office. So people want to know what my platform is, and it's simple. It's one is I'm going to hold violent, dangerous offenders accountable for the acts they do against victims. I think that's important to give victims their voices back. Number two is we're going to try our best to whip this fentanyl epidemic. We're going to try to give treatment to people who are addicted and prosecute those who traffic in this poison. And number three, we hope to reduce what we call like we like to call the crime tax, which is crimes against businesses and homes, which cause us to, you know, which leads to burglaries and trespass and loss of inventory, organized retail theft. So we want to make sure we address and keep our community safe and prosperous, because businesses thrive, communities thrive when they feel safe. So those are my platforms. And I know I've spoken to hundreds and hundreds of people. And I know people have heard my stump speech or heard me speak a lot of times. So, but I think a lot of good information comes from Q&A. So I know I had 10 minutes, but I want to really open up the floor to ask for people to ask me any kind of questions they want, because this is here. I'm here for you, and I want you to hear me answer your questions, the things that concern you the most.
Thank you very much. So I encourage people, if you have a question, please put it in the chat, and Monica will spot that and read your question for you.
Okay, I've got a few questions that were submitted before the meeting. Can you hear me okay?
I sure can.
All right. What are the three most important differences between you and your opponent?
We do one at a time? That's great. So the big difference is I'm a career prosecutor. I've been prosecuting for a long, long time. I've prosecuted cases from homicides to burglaries to some of the largest white collar cases in Arizona history. I've also prosecuted cops and judges and legislative elected officials. That's number one. Number two is I have over 125 jury trials. And so I've been a jury prosecutor for a long time. I don't think my opponent has ever had a jury trial whatsoever. And I think those are two big qualifying factors, because it matters for the county attorney to understand about charging, about investigations, and about mentoring and how to run the office. If you've been a prosecutor, this is the top prosecuting position. And also is I have been a community activist my entire life. I've been a Special Olympics coach. I have been a volunteer for Habitat Humanity. I have been on the boards for Tucson Museum of Art, Tucson Clean and Beautiful. I don't need selfies for it. I do it because I enjoy my community. I want to make my community better. I learned those lessons from my father and my mother. And so those are the big three differences between me and Ms. Conover.
Okay, so there's a few questions starting to roll in. Can you say something nice?
Can I say something nice? Yes, I think we're all wonderful to be here.
Your respect about your opponent.
I didn't hear you. What?
Can you say something nice or something with respect about your opponent?
Oh, sure. I mean, I think my opponent means well. I mean, I think we all have the same philosophy here. We want restorative justice. We want to do the things that we're trying to promote. You know, we move forward as a society in how we treat defendants and how we move forward. So the difference between the two of us, though, is who can do the actual job. For example, I mean, her philosophy of how to do the office is admirable. We all have that same philosophy. We wouldn't be here in the Democratic Party if we didn't have the same philosophy on how to do this criminal justice reform. The difference is, can you do the job? And so, for example, she created a restorative justice program which has zero cases so far. Zero. There's been a pushback from domestic violence prosecution. So there's been a CJB board where juveniles are diverted over from juvenile system into a CJB system that has been neglected. So I admire the philosophy. I do. And so I hold the same philosophies a lot of way. I think there's been some articles written that we don't disagree on philosophy. We disagree on implementation and experience. That's where we differ.
All right. Thank you. Next question. County attorney is an administrative job, not a courtroom attorney job. How does your experience translate?
Well, that's a great question. I've been a supervisor. I've set up offices overseas for Department of Justice. I mean, I've handled some of the biggest biggest responsibilities for the Department of Justice that you can imagine. So budgets of, with U.S. money, millions of dollars from U.S. money to UN money to Pakistani money, coalescing into building up prosecution offices overseas. So I have administrated, you know, large offices of 120 prosecutors. I've hired, trained. I think it's important, though. I don't want to negate the fact of being a prosecutor, because being a prosecutor is important, because understanding investigations, understanding how to talk and work with law enforcement, and understanding how to mentor is important for the job too. You're right, it's an administrative role. However, you still need to have the experience, because you're going to be teaching, mentoring these prosecutors. And so you need to have some leadership. You've been there before. I've handled some of the biggest white collar cases in Arizona, from the 214th Air National Guard to Rio Nuevo. So if a case comes into this office, I have the experience and the knowledge how to adjudicate that case. And so I think it's important. You're right, administrative, but you need to have some experience prosecuting cases.
All right, next question. Would you refuse to prosecute doctors or patients if abortion is illegal?
I didn't hear the first part. Can you repeat that first part?
Yeah. Would you refuse to prosecute doctors or patients if abortion is illegal?
I've said this countless times. I'm not prosecuting a woman or a provider for an abortion. I've said that countless times. I'm going to use the discretion of the office. I'm not doing it.
What is your experience on the civil component of the office?
On the civil component?
Yeah.
Yeah, I have, you know, for this office, I mean, most of my experience for the 17 years has been criminal, but I've handled civil issues for the Department of Justice overseas on an international level. I also, when I graduated from Lewis and Clark in Portland, I worked for Bullivant Hauser Bailey, a big law firm in Portland. So I have some civil experience, yes, but you know, most of my experience though has been criminal, but I have handled civil and administrative responsibilities for the Department of Justice for, you know, the past 4 or 5 years.
There seem to be a few questions about donations from Republicans. Do you care to comment on that in your campaign?
Yeah, what was the first part of that question? I'm sorry, you're really soft-spoken. Sorry about that.
There seem to be a few comments asking about donations from Republicans to your campaign. Would you care to comment on that?
Yeah, this is, you know, I find this, you know, thanks for the question. I mean, I find this to be sometimes exhausting to talk about. I do have some Republican donors. I mean, donors donate for different reasons. And despite the fact that I'm pro-choice, pro-environment, some Republicans donate because either they're business owners. I think my opponent on this is, I'm going to bring up something which is unfortunate. My opponent brought up on a mailer, put one of my donors on a mailer, which went out to thousands and thousands of people, which is unfortunate for the donor. I mean, you isolating one donor and highlighting that person and sending a mailer out to thousands of people without any regard to the person. And now there is trying to associate me with this individual without any kind of curiosity. I've been a white collar prosecutor for 17 years. And I've handled a lot of cases with a lot of victims. And I'm so glad this came up, because that individual on that mailer was a victim in one of my cases. And so to highlight that person and to associate their political views with me when that person was a victim of mine, maybe that person was appreciative of the work product that I did and the representation for them as a victim in a criminal case, that they thought maybe I would be a great county attorney. And it gives me another opportunity to say something too, is the county attorney represents the entire county, Democrats, Republicans. And despite that, I still get support from businesses. I get support from Republicans. I get support from independents. And the last thing I'll say on that is, I just think American politics, we have become, we have drilled down on certain things and we're going to find one donor for Mr. Jette. We're going to find a donor for Mr. Jette that has this anti-democratic philosophy. And we're going to say to Mr. Jette that he's no longer qualified, despite the 17 years, despite the 125 jury trials, despite the work he's done for county and state and federal. Despite all that, Mr. Jette received some funding from a Republican donor. And because of that, he shouldn't be qualified to be the Democratic primary candidate. So I find that to be a troubling result of this focus on the Republican donation. But to on the mailer, though, I find it to be troublesome that without even thinking about possibly this individual donates to me because of a different reason. So I find that it's troubling that we highlight that. So.
All right. Thank you. I've got just a couple more questions. Where do you stand on gun laws? Where do you stand on school administration having guns on campus?
Well, gun laws is a broad thing. So, I mean, I'm all for legislating guns. I know I'm a butt up against the Second Amendment and other people's philosophy, but I don't think somebody should have an AR-15. So I grew up in a Marine Corps house with a hunting family. I'm okay with a rifle. I'm okay with a handgun. I'm not okay with an AR-15. I'm also not okay with prohibited possessors having guns. I'm also not okay with straw buyers being able to buy a gun. I'm also not okay with people buying guns in a loophole of a gun show. I'm not okay with that whatsoever. And so I'll do my darndest to lobby and to change legislation to make those things more difficult. And so I'm all for legislating smart gun laws, because I think we've got gun violence. We have got the overuse of guns in our community. And do I think schools should have guns? Unfortunately, the answer is absolutely not. I don't think school administrators should be arming themselves and ratcheting up the escalating violence in schools. So I don't believe in that. I think we need to curtail this problem before it even reaches to a school. So this is a very complicated issue. I'm all on board with more legislation. I don't think the Second Amendment was meant to have a weapon that fires 30 rounds in a sec. I just got done with a case down south where AK-47 can fire 30 rounds in, I think, 3 seconds or something like that. That's ridiculous to me.
Thank you. Last question is, what do you mean when you say you're pro-environment?
Oh, I believe, well, this comes up all the time. So I'm all for the clean air, clean water, but I'm also a believer in man-made climate change. I believe that man has caused this. I think we need to have renewable energy sources. I think we need to have better legislation on who dumps, where they dump. And I think we have to have a better mechanism of enforcing these laws, because we live in this environment. Those contaminants spread and flow and get into everything we have. My brother, I'm just going to let you know, we grew up in Camp Lejeune, North Carolina. And if you guys do not know, Camp Lejeune, North Carolina is the subject of the largest civil case, tort case in U.S. history because of the contaminants that were spread in the water system. And both my brothers got sick from that. And so I do believe that we need to be careful what we do with our Mother Earth. We need to be careful what we put in the air, put in the water. And I do believe in man-made change of climate change, which is an existential threat to our society. And I'm anything we can do to avert this, I'm all on board. We're going to do everything we can, because I think that is the biggest threat of man. I've been in Bangladesh, and if you guys don't know, Bangladesh is, I think, below sea level for most of Bangladesh. Dhaka is below sea level, and I've seen flooding of catastrophic levels in Bangladesh. And so I've seen firsthand what global warming does and global warming does. I mean, millions and millions and millions of people are in play here. So,
all right, thank you.
Thank you very much, Mike. We appreciate everything you had to say. And thank you for taking some questions. And now it is the turn for Laura Conover to speak. Laura, please unmute yourself and turn on your video. You have 10 minutes to tell us about yourself and your platform, and then we'll follow up with 10 minutes of Q&A.
Well, let me ask first, can you all see and hear me? Because now it's just gone to a massive like bobblehead of just my face. Can you see and hear me?
Yes, you look fine.
Thank you. Well, I may look, in fact, quite a little bit heat-worn, because we are fully fledged into our get out the vote efforts, not only for my campaign, but for all of the campaigns that we are lifting up that are so important to each and every one of you on this call. When I am in Stephanie Stahl Hamilton's district, we carry her literature with us. When I am in Kirsten Ingalls' district, we carry her literature with us. And I knocked on 40 doors Saturday morning and another 40 doors Sunday morning. And obviously I've been out in the heat this evening because it's not just our campaign that we have to worry about. It's the state, it's the flipping the state legislature, and it's making sure Kirsten is our next congresswoman. Why? Of course, because as the prosecutor who had the chance to speak for the entire state and to take on Attorney General Brnovich at the time on reproductive health, and winning that case at the Court of Appeals has brought everything home to how fundamentally important the race for Pima County Attorney is. This job holds so much extraordinary power as both the head of all of law enforcement, the top prosecutor for Pima County, and also the county's attorney on the civil side and the head of the health law unit that helped me go confidently and strongly into court for reproductive health and winning 2.5 years worth of healthcare statewide that was so critical until we get our abortion initiative across the line. So I'm not going to waste all of your time because we are past mailing in ballots and we are firmly in get out the vote leading up to a week from now to election day on Tuesday. And so I'm going to try to hit some points squarely. I'm going to respond to a few comments that my opponent just made, and we'll start right there. When he says that it was unfair to name a specific individual on a mailer that we sent out that I signed my name to, because that is the only sincere and honest way to get messaging out. I signed my name to that and I paid for it, which we declared, because it is critical that primary voters know that David Meehl, that's the name we're talking about. David Meehl, who has a legacy, a multi-year legacy of the redistricting campaign that all of you and I have suffered through, and what that did to redistricting and what that did to LD17, our neighbors to the north and west. But it's not that so much as that he gave generously to my opponent, and then reversed that. He gave $20,000 of his own money to defeat and foil our abortion initiative statewide. And then he gave generously to my opponent. And if that is one name that is so critical to all of us understanding where my opponent stands, it's not the one name. It's not the one name. It's Jim Click writing a max check of $6,650 to my opponent. It's every car dealer. It's every land developer and broker and banker and financier. It is all of the who's who. It is Bruce Ash writing a mass check as the RNC national committeeman who helped carry Trump over the line in 2016. It is the who's who of every influential Republican that any Republican candidate for office would want. And it must be addressed as a public record going before us. It's not one. So in other words, it's not one, right? It's the many. It's the many. It's the entire record before the voting population that must be taken into account. And I agree wholeheartedly with the letter to the editor that came in this weekend that said, who has bought and paid for this campaign? My opponent also has not a single person on salary that he pays for his campaign. And that's because he has avowed that the prior administration has supported him and will be coming back into office. And the support is such that, and they are here tonight, that they have gone all in and don't draw a salary to carry his campaign forward. So now let's take 2 minutes, if we will, and then it's important to turn to your questions about what's on the line here. Our core democratic fundamental values. I have confessed many a time that I did not know when I filed for office in November of 2019 that I would be relitigating so many fundamental rights that so many of you had fought so hard for. Rights to make choices over our own medical choices, over our own healthcare, over our own bodies. The right to cast freely and fairly and safely our ballot for office. And this has been top of mind. And that's on the civil side. That's on the civil division as the county's attorney. And on the criminal side, we have ushered in all of the reforms that I promised. And has that ruffled feathers? Oh, you bet it has. The prior administration, and most importantly, the fact that no one owns me. No one owns me. I am my own person. I carry you in my heart. I am grassroots. I am of the people. There is not the opportunity to pick up a phone and to tell Laura what to do. And if that was the way previously, I'm sorry for it. And if that is the way to be coming forward, if I lose this campaign, I'm sorry for it for our campaign again. But I stand for our core fundamental values, what I campaigned on and what I'm going forward on. And even though I ushered in the reforms that I promised on the death penalty, on treating juveniles as children, on keeping every child out of adult court, on moving thousands of people into treatment safely and responsibly instead of felonizing their substance use disorder and mental health, we kept public safety at the forefront of our mind as well. We did it all. Every single marker of violent crime is down right now. And so I'm asking you to go forward with me and not backwards. I'm asking you to help me build forward where we're going instead of going back to the previous administration. And with that, I would love to take your questions. Ask me anything.
All right. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, the chat is open. Please put your questions in the chat. I know a number of them have already been placed there. And Monica will get to the most relevant questions.
I'll take over. And I'll ask you a similar question. The county attorney's an administrative job, not a courtroom attorney job. How does your experience translate?
Well, like the constant misinformation and disinformation from my opponent and from the dark money super PAC out of Ohio, I have to correct the record again. He just told you that I've never done any jury trials, and I'm so proud of all of my jury trials. They were wonderful and fun experiences. And the most recent jury trial I did in federal court, I dare say, and here's an opportunity to brag, my most recent jury trial in federal court landed in a Ninth Circuit opinion that lasts today, that talks about the victim of domestic violence and his or her right to call an expert witness to trial. And that is still the law of the land in the Ninth Circuit. And it's also an example of my opponent's willingness to literally falsify information when we all know that the public record is clear about all of my trials across all of jurisdictions. But as we recall, this is not a trial job. And if I were to carry a caseload, that would be an extraordinary abdication of all of my duties, running an office of 380 employees and 250 volunteers and a $42 million budget. And so, of course, it's an administrative job. And I had that kind of experience beforehand. I'm not sure that my opponent ever supervised at the Attorney General's office or at the U.S. Attorney's office locally, but I had the opportunity to take a massive supervision job at the behest and appointment of the federal bench before I took office. And it's been my honor to be an administrator of such extraordinary civil servants during the most difficult time the last 3.5 years.
Okay, our next question. You have taken a lot of criticism from judges and others in the legal community, including groups like Emerge. Help us understand why.
Well, the response, I will say that the response from the judges was disappointing when I first arrived. I'm in a room full of Democrats, and so I do think you should know that we have one remaining judge on the bench from that was appointed by by Governor Napolitano, and every other single judge was appointed by Brewer and Ducey. So to say that they weren't ready for a reform prosecutor is probably the understatement of the century. Nevertheless, I have triumphed over that. The only complaints coming from judges, in fact, if you take a look, are retired. They're off the bench. They're not currently on the bench. But my job, let's be clear. My job is not to please the bench. My job is to represent the county and the community and justice. They have their own job, and the natural and healthy check and balance is to be a check upon their power. And they have power, which is a check upon me. And so my job is by no means to make best friends with those that I am supposed to keep in check. And again, I'll return to the fact that no one controls me. No one can pick up the phone and call the shots on a particular high-profile case. The only law of the land is to do the right thing. And that is uncomfortable for everyone in the previous establishment because it's not the way things were before me.
All right. Thank you. What is happening with the restorative justice program?
Oh, Thank you for asking. There's so much misinformation even in what my opponent just said a few minutes ago. And I'll give him a pass on this one. You know, when he talks about me never having done a jury trial, that's so crazy because it's all public record for the last 20 years. But when he says that there are no cases yet in restorative justice, let's give him a pass because that's confidential work. That's really sensitive between victims of harm and the people who caused the harm coming together to try to make a victim as nearly whole as possible. So he would simply perhaps not know that we are in the middle of half a dozen cases that we are piloting right now because it's brand new. And it's so exciting and so wonderful. It is the future of justice. And for those of you who don't know what restorative justice is, I would be delighted to tell you that it is the way in which we take cases that victims choose, because victims are completely empowered to choose whether their case goes into restorative justice. And then they are empowered about how they choose to participate. But it is a process that returns a victim to as nearly whole as possible, with results that so often are so much better than our traditional system. And it requires the person who has caused the harm to be so completely accountable and answerable to even the direct questions of the person who caused them harm. And so you will not be surprised that the success rate of people who go through restorative justice from never causing any harm again is incredible, because they have so learned from the harm that they caused. And we are deeply happy to be engaged in going after root causes of harm. And I'm so grateful to the relationships we built with the Pasquayaki tribe and the Tohono O'odham Nation, who helped us build this. We have a huge relationship with both now, in better serving Indigenous victims, tribal and nation member victims as well.
What do you see as your biggest accomplishments of your administration?
It's humbling. It's humbling because the people who work in our agency, they could make a fortune in private practice, but they stay in service to you and in service to our community. And retaining them and raising their salaries for the first time in decades, improving their quality of life within the agency, I think has a ripple effect. We modernized the office. We got off of a paper file system. We have a new text messaging system for victims that better serves them. We got rid of the death penalty. We keep children out of adult court every single time we can. We created those first in the nation tribal and nation specially deputized prosecutors. We got the new fraud unit off the ground and hit $1 million in restitution at the year mark, and we ushered in the reforms we promised you, and even on top of that, we're so proud that every single marker of violent crime is down. We are reformers, and yet we are strong partners to law enforcement. We have a very, very long ways to go, We have a lot of work to do. And if given another chance, we're up for it.
All right, one final question. What do you admire about your opponent?
There's a lot. I tried to ask him to 4 years ago to help me launch my fraud unit because he has a great background in fraud. I don't think that's come out yet publicly, but it's true because he has a good background in fraud. And I think his willingness to go abroad, I've thanked him for it before, you know, to go into a hard part of the world. Is so admirable. And I think what I was doing here during COVID and trying to come into an agency and just even in that first year, trying to just keep my people alive, is also admirable, but he really put himself out there all the way across the world. And I respect that deeply.
Great. Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you, Laura, for making your presentation and answering the questions. And also, Mike Jette, I want to thank you for appearing tonight and answering questions. And there still is time to vote. The time to mail in your ballot may have passed, but there are opportunities to vote in person. You can vote at 18 different vote centers. And it's time to make your voice heard.